we should open up as soon as we can, because the cure has become worse than the disease. It's a nightmare. And if you look at all the people, Stephanie, who are for keeping a lockdown, they all have got paychecks. Find me somebody who doesn't have a paycheck who wants to keep a lockdown. And there also seems to be a dichotomy between the Democrats and Republicans, the whole idea of freedom of expression, independence. And I think it's an outrage that someone was fined $500 for watching an Easter service in their parked car.
Joining me now is the rather famous billionaire investor, Freeze Associates founder and donor and part owner of the Daily Caller, Foster Freeze. Foster, thank you so much for joining us.
Well, it's a delight to be here, Stephanie, with you. And I love this Zoom capability so we can see each other face to face and have a little chat about the world going around us.
Absolutely. And for those of you watching, please don't forget to like and subscribe to the Daily Caller. Now, Foster, I want to get your take on the reopening of America. We're starting to see states go through phases as we want to get the economy going again and get Americans back to work amid the coronavirus.
Well, it never should have been shut down the way it was. You can't treat people in Wheatland, Wyoming, and Sedona, Arizona, where they have very few incidents, the same way you treat New York City. So I admire Kristi Noem, the governor of South Dakota, who kind of kept things functioning pretty much on track. She had one problem with a meatpacking plant, which was purchased by the Chinese a few years back. And so I'm grateful that they're now allowing things to happen that should have been happening all along. If you look at some of these barber shops or workout facilities, there's only one or two people in them at a time and only two or three employees. So the chance of the coronavirus spreading was pretty minimal. Now, I want to make sure that we don't take this thing as just like the normal flu, because it is not. It's much worse than the flu, and the safety issues are paramount. But I agree that we should open up as soon as we can, because the cure has become worse than the disease. It's a nightmare. And if you look at all the people, Stephanie, who are for keeping a lockdown, they all have got paychecks. Find me somebody who doesn't have a paycheck who wants to keep a lockdown. And there also seems to be a dichotomy between the Democrats and Republicans, the whole idea of freedom of expression, independence. And I think it's an outrage that someone was fined $500 for watching an Easter service in their parked car.
Yeah, it's pretty
crazy. Too much government.
And as you pointed out, we don't want the cure to actually be worse than the virus itself, which is what President Trump has been saying on along. And there are some who criticize those of us who want to see our economy get going again and get started. I mean, we have people that are talking about keeping things shut down until like the new year, next year. It's kind of crazy that people don't want to figure things out. I wanted to get your thoughts on this. A senior economic advisor to President Trump said that the U.S. is likely to experience a GDP decline between 20 and 30% in the second quarter. How concerned are you for our economy, and how do we recover?
Well, that expert has a better figure as to what the numbers are, but I just am concerned if it was 10%, because if it's only 10%, who are the people that are going to be hurt by it? It's not the Wall Street types, and if it gets restored, we're not concerned about the Wall Street portfolios going up. We're concerned about the everyday workers in the restaurants and the hotel housekeepers. These are the people that we have to look out for. And I just think it's an outrage where people who talk about that, if they want to give credibility to their position, tell them they'll forego their all their income for that period of time, much like the National Football League commissioner gave up his salary.
Yeah, and what do you say to those people who claim that the only people who want to get the economy going are those who want to enrich Wall Street?
Well, I think that's a classic left-wing propaganda, because the Wall Street numbers aren't all down that much from where they were 2-3 years ago. And the thing we have to be concerned about, people of wealth have been blessed, and they ought to make sure they pass that blessing along to the people who don't have a job right now. In fact, I'd like to show you a picture that happened. I was on the campaign trail, I don't know if you can see that or not, for Wyoming governor, and I ran into these guys in a welding shop. And it was such an emotional moment when I saw the picture, because the contrast of my white shirt and their sootiness of working all day. And I said, these are the people that have to cheer for. And if I look at all the people who want to stop the lockdown, they're not Wall Street types. I mean, the ones who want to open the economy, they're not Wall Streeters. They're barbers and people who are working every day to try to make a living. Restaurant owners, hotel housekeepers, let's cheer for them.
Yeah, and that's something that I've kind of been talking about because, you know, I'm sitting here, I'm comfortable, I have a job, I have a platform. I am for reopening the economy in a safe way. It's a balancing act, as you pointed out. The coronavirus isn't like the flu. It's very contagious. It's deadly. There's a lot of stuff that we just don't know about it. But you're so right that it's not the Wall Street folks or the news pundits or the politicians who are receiving paychecks that are calling for things to stay or to reopen. It is the American workers who want to get back to work, who don't want a government handout, or those who aren't even getting the handouts, right? A lot of American businesses have been promised a certain amount of money. A lot of them haven't received any sort of assistance from the government, and they're wondering how much longer they can stay shut down without any sort of guarantee of help.
Well, Stephanie, what these restaurant owners need is customers, not cash. There's not enough cash to keep them alive, because if they get a cash payment, they don't know if the local government is going to keep the restaurant closed for the next 2 months. So I think the most important thing is to allow each of these groups to come together and advise the governments what they think is the best way of being safe, and let them participate rather than a top-down decision about you will stay locked up. I think it's an outrage that the actual owners of these facilities and the customers. If the customer thinks he's at risk, he doesn't have to go there. And people who are at risk can stay home. So when I was a kid, I'd walk to school and walk past houses that are quarantined. In those days, we quarantined the sick. And our big scourge in those days was not COVID-19, it was polio. People would have to stay in iron lungs. But we walked past those houses that were quarantined for various reasons, and we took those risks. We took the risk of, you know, the Nazi bullets shooting at our 18-year-olds and 19-year-olds. I'm just so concerned. Maybe our Americans have become too risk-averse. I mean, we have to be careful, but we also should take a certain amount of risk to be able to look out for the people who make our economy work. They're just devastated.
Yeah. And I'm just wondering what you would do if you were a small business owner and in your area, there were still rules and restrictions on when you could reopen, but you were facing, you know, maybe going to serious debt or having to close down. What would you do? We're seeing all these reports of defiant businesses operating despite what their local governments are saying.
Well, I'm not a very defiant person. I do everything my wife tells me to do. So I have to pay attention. You know, early on in our relationship, I kind of messed up and Lynn body slammed me, and I've been good ever since.
So any advice for these business owners who are kind of...
Well, I think I have great compassion, and if they go out and demonstrate, I would be all for them doing that, because what America is about is freedom of expression. They run a risk by opening up that restaurant, because if one person gets sick from coronavirus, they're closed down again, probably. Yeah. So they run the risk of opening up. And two, the patron takes the risk. Nobody has to go to that restaurant. And, you know, if you right now, I crave anything. There's two things. I want a dozen shuck oysters and a haircut. I can hardly wait.
I'm sure you could. Maybe your wife can cut your hair. Did you ask?
No, No. We did that once. That was the last time we did that.
And I'm sure you saw it. I mean, I just can't believe I'm even reading this headline. Jobless claims climbed to 30 million in 6 weeks as COVID layoffs continue to rise. That is devastating.
Yeah, but it's in 6 weeks. But unfortunately, if we suddenly said, okay, you're all open for business, go for it, those are not going to come back. There's going to be a slow comeback, because how many people are going to get on an airplane, know that coronavirus is still a risk? How many people will want to travel or go to a restaurant? People will be careful on their own. Now, here's an industry statistic which works to your benefit, Stephanie. If you look at the 27,000 deaths that were reported recently, and I wish I could get the same statistics for 60,000 deaths, but I don't have it. Maybe they're the same. But it shows that people 34 years and younger, the amount of people that died of those 27,000 was 0.1%. If you take people 55 and older, those people comprise 90% of the people that died. Now, that's a pretty powerful argument for maybe we don't have to be quite so cautious about schools, universities, and activities where young people are engaged. It seems like the people that are dying are older and people with other illnesses. It's tragic to find out why in some of these areas the proportion of blacks dying is higher than the proportion that they represent in the universe, in the population. And I hope someone's going to find out why is that. It's not, I don't believe, because they're like sickle cell and anemia where they have a proclivity, but it could be something as simple as diet. Do they get enough vitamin C and D, which I'm now learning is very important from the immunity. I've been kind of taking those supplements for a while, and now someone told me I'll be taking more zinc. So I just think we have to do more research to find out why that's happening.
Yeah, absolutely. Which kind of what you were just saying kind of brings me to my next point, is that there are some people in our country who are questioning even the fact that we went into lockdown, and they use Sweden as an example that didn't go this far. So do you question how our country handled coronavirus? And also, how do you think the Trump administration has handled it?
Well, I was a leader of about 70, 80 people, and I love idea that once I made a decision, folks rallied behind me. And the whole idea of being a leader, follow your leader. And we can't all make the decisions. And so I agonize for people in these very cities who are in a tough spot, because if they do open it up and someone dies, they're going to be criticized. But at the same time, if they don't open up, it's going to be devastating to our economy for a long, long time. So I'll let people decide what they want to do.
Yes. And I want to talk about the one bill, one subject, which is a very relevant idea right now, considering when it was the last stimulus of $2 trillion, a lot of money went to kind of like rather odd places. For example, the Kennedy Center received $25 million?
Well, yeah, right.
And
well, that was kind of
$75 million, something like that. And a lot of people were wondering what that had to do with coronavirus and why these organizations were the winners of our hard-earned taxpayer dollars.
So, Stephanie, I think that's a fabulous answer. And that's what inspired the whole one bill, one subject. It was introduced about two years back in Congress. It got 41 sponsors. Right now, the first day, we got 6 sponsors because it's more timely now. And people see this as a possible manifestation of the 1966 Cloward-Piven strategy. These two socialists decided that if we can bankrupt and overwhelm the welfare system, then we could get people excited about having guaranteed annual incomes. And there was a whole agenda to turn our company over to a socialist country by Cloward and Piven. And why do we want to put all these things which delayed the aid to the coronavirus effort? And I think it held up a number of days. So that's why there's every American that we propose this to out in the colonies gives us a high five and say, yes, it's about the right time. Republicans and Democrats love taking their most favorable idea, which is repugnant oftentimes to the American public, and attach it to a bill that has to pass, or they hook it up with the other side and say, look, you hate this and I hate this idea of yours, let's put them together. And American public, the welders and all my hardworking Americans lose out. So I believe that Andy Biggs, who's the congressman in Arizona, is the sponsor of Bill 6635. It just got launched about 2 days ago. And so I hope everybody listening to this will call up their congressman and say, you should be on this bill. One bill, one subject, and we could turn America back to a country that Mom Freeze will be able to understand.
Yeah. What do you think the chances of something like this passing? Not all of our members of Congress are as brave and outspoken and willing to go in there and fight as Congressman Andy Biggs is from Arizona. I know him pretty well, that's why I can say it.
Yeah, well, we're going to give them a little courage, because for those that are recalcitrant, we're going to put a little billboard in their community and say, why, call your Congressman Joe Blow and ask why he's opposed to letting me see how my money is being spent. Why hasn't he voted for one bill, one subject? And so with the social media now available to us, those people who aren't going to line up and want to do this are going to suffer some pretty significant ramifications, perhaps in November, as to why would they oppose something like that? What's the agenda that they would be against that when the American public are so overwhelming for it? Talk to all your friends. Call all your Daily Caller pals and see if you can find anybody opposed to that idea. Nobody.
Yeah, exactly. And I think you make a great point that this isn't just like a Republican or Democrat issue. Both sides are guilty of spending our taxpayer dollar money like monopoly money. It's outrageous. I wanted to circle back and get your thoughts on whether or not China should be held accountable for the impact coronavirus has had in our country. Like, we don't know exactly where the virus came from. There's a lot of theories out there. So until we know for sure, I don't want to even say anything about that. But we do know that China had advanced knowledge of how exactly the coronavirus spread and the effects that it had on their people. So there's a lot of conversation about the fact that had China been transparent with the United States, had they worked with the CDC, we could have prevented a lot of tragedy and death here in this country.
Well, I think that's very accurate, but I don't see how it's realistic to hold them accountable. You're not going to have a court hearing and say, okay, you owe us $3 trillion. I doubt if that's going to happen, but it's okay to kind of get up on the soapbox and make a plea for it and to make a point out of it. But I find it very curious, and maybe as a reporter, you can track this down. I'm not sure if it's true or not. I am assuming, Stephanie, you've gotten this email, "Don't believe everything you read on the internet," signed Abraham Lincoln.
No, I didn't get that one.
So this might be in that category, but I'm told that the Ministry of Health of Iran was at Wuhan and contracted the virus and died. Now, what was the Minister of Health from Iran doing at this biological lab that apparently is designed to come up with biological warfare potentially? And then another rumor I heard is that they burned it down. So we don't really have enough information, but the whole notion that we're going to force the Chinese to close down their wet markets where meat is processed maybe unsanitarily, those have been going on for decades. And so did we able to track all the other viruses that started epidemics came in from the wet markets? It's not scientific, and it's kind of a gut reaction, and I don't think we should demand that until we have more science. Now, I don't mind to tell you that I'm a fan of Lindsey Graham, who's wants to close them down, but I'll forgive him for that.
Yeah, I've had some conversations with other people and experts about the wet markets. They sound pretty nasty. It sounds like a place where, you know, viruses and bacteria and stuff can thrive. And, a lot of people take issue with some of the, I guess, food that they're serving there, like bats and dogs and cats and really crazy things. Well, Foster, thank you so much. I'm going to leave it here. We really appreciate your insight and everything that you do for us here at the Daily Caller.
Well, I'm delighted to be a fan of Daily Caller and Neil Patel and Tucker. Of course, he's less active now that he's become this wealthy guy every night spouting out this wisdom. But I love both those guys, and I love all my Daily Caller colleagues, and so grateful for what you accomplished in terms of uncovering things that would never come to light if it weren't for you. So you're a very important part of America's return to its civility and its kindness and its truthfulness, and keep it up, because we very, very much need you. God bless. We're going to take you all, going to help turn America into a Philippians 4:8 land. Philippians 4:8, whatever is good, whatever is right, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is deserving of praise, dwell on these things. And we're headed that way thanks to all the Daily Caller inputs. God bless you all.